Welcome back. We now start to look at project risk management. But before we do that, let's look at the context and why this topic is important. Previously, we looked at how investors and lenders assess an investment. We saw that they apply financial analysis to decide whether to invest in something or not, that they focus on the cash flows generated by an investment and then analyze the returns they can expect. Then we applied that to the funding of projects. We saw that a specialty area of project finance has developed. We saw that in project finance, we contain the financing purely to the project by means of a special purpose vehicle or SPV that legally ring-fences the cash flows of the project. The consequence of this is that we look purely at the cash flows of the project. They need to be predictable and transparent. If the project cash flows are not predictable and transparent, for example, due to the occurrence of substantial project risks, the investors will not be able to determine their expected return. And then they'll not want to invest, and the project financing will fail. Even if the project cash flows are clear and transparent, they may be unstable, for example, due to the occurrence of substantial project risks. Then investors will want to see a higher return on their investment to compensate them for taking more investment risks. If the funding cost is too high due to these project risks, the project returns may be insufficient to service the required funding cost. An example, if a project can realistically only generate a return of 8%, but investors want a return of 10%, then the project financing will also fail. This interplay between risk and expected investment return demonstrates that it is crucial in project management to do everything you can to analyze the risks and stabilize the cash flows. We do that through risk management. That is, anticipating risks and putting in place mitigating measures whenever that's possible. Because this is such an important topic, project finance has developed a rigorous, standardized, and thorough process for this, with years of experience that went to its development. Following this risk management process will greatly improve the likelihood of a successful financing. So when do we do this risk management? Well, first, let's look at the project phases. The legal start of a project is usually called a closing. It's a session where all the project contracts are signed and the rights and responsibilities of all the participants are frozen. After closing, the construction can begin. Closing is where the project development phase ends and the construction phase begins. And completion, or commissioning, is when the construction phase ends and the project assets start operation. That's the operating phase. Risks can occur at different moments and in all these phases. Risk management is therefore a dynamic process that needs to take place in all these project phases. That means that risk management needs to be repeated from time to time. Risks and possible risk mitigations will change as the project progresses. For example, construction risks will have fallen away once the construction is completed, and there may be new insights and technical developments that can be taken on board when they occur. It's important to begin the risk management process very early on, particularly in the project development phase. There are three reasons for this. First, when you approach an investor or a lender, he'll ask you pertinent questions about the impact of project risks for the expected cash flows. And if you don't have acceptable answers, they'll lose interest quickly and may walk away. We need to keep in mind that investors, and particularly lending banks, are not risk tolerant. They have a limited knowledge of your project, and they can't easily invent possible risk mitigation opportunities. That's not their job. If you've done your homework, prepared a risk management and mitigation plan that will pay off in success. Furthermore, their lack of knowledge also makes the investor or lender more skeptical towards your project. That was reason number one. Reason number two, At the time of closing, the project funding rates are locked in. Often for many years, all the work that you've done to reduce the risk at that point in time will help to reduce the funding rates. With a 20-year financing, that homework will pay off over 20 years. It's a good investment. The third reason to start early: if you do not succeed in the project financing, all the project development costs will be lost forever. We call that sunk costs. And in a large and complex project, the development costs can be millions of dollars. All the more reason to focus carefully on risk management early on and to identify potential deal killers as soon as possible. Project finance is essentially a risk distribution system. All the risks that are retained by the project company, by the SPV, will increase the funding cost or may even make the project financing fail. We just saw that. So we go to great lengths to allocate the risks to other parties. We try to allocate the risk away from the SPV to a party that is best able to assess and manage a particular risk. Let me give you some examples of this. For a construction risk, that's often a building firm. But a financial institution will not be keen to assume such a risk. But a currency risk, on the other hand, for example, the conversion of euros into dollars at an ever-changing exchange rate, a financial institution will be better placed to assess and assume this risk for a price, because currencies are part of the core business of a financial institution. Third example, for their sales risk, being able to sell a product or service that is produced by the project, often the intended buyer will know best how to manage that. If, for example, the project company builds a power plant, the sales risk of electricity is best assessed by a power utility company. We can try to allocate that risk to that utility through a so-called power purchase agreement, or PPA. We'll see later on that that is exactly what happens in such situations. The party who's best able to assess and manage a particular risk is also most likely to give you the best price for assuming that risk, because all risk transfers will cost the SPV money. If we can't find a contract party who's willing to assume a certain risk, we can try to insure that risk with an insurance company. This could, for example, be the case for the risk of an earthquake occurring. If insuring risks turns out not to be possible, then the SPV will be left with the risk, and then we can only hope that such a residual risk does not block the project financing. And if it does, a project may not be independently financeable, unless we can get financial support, for example, from a government or an international agency. Thank you for listening, and see you soon.